There are many engineering problems where you might want to find the eigenvalues and the eigenvectors of a matrix. MATLAB has very good routines for that, and you should use them. But I think for your education, it's worthwhile to at least learn one simple method of finding the largest eigenvalue of a matrix. That's called the eigenvalue power method. So in this video, I want to derive what the method is, and in the next video, we'll work a simple example. So let's just work with real matrices. So A is an n by n real matrix, and we might as well assume it has real eigenvalues and eigenvectors. So we have n real distinct eigenvalues. And let's order them. So we have the largest one I'll call lambda 1. So the absolute value of lambda 1, whether positive or negative, it doesn't matter, but it has to be the largest one. So it's larger than lambda 2, which is larger than all the other ones. And then the smallest one will be lambda sub n. And each of these eigenvalues also has an associated eigenvector. So we have, we'll call those E, so E1, E2, through En. Okay, for n distinct eigenvalues, the eigenvectors are linearly independent. So we have n linearly independent eigenvectors. So any column vector, n by 1 column vector, should be written in terms of a linear, can be written in terms of a linear combination of the n eigenvectors. So let's call a vector x naught. Okay, any arbitrary vector x naught can be written as a linear combination of e1 through en. So I'll write that as c1 e1 plus c2 e2 plus cn en. So the c's are just real constants. The e's are the eigenvectors. In the summation notation, this is the sum from I equals 1 to n of ci ei. Okay. Now let's ask what happens to this vector when we multiply by the matrix A. So if we call that x1, which is A times x naught, this is A times the sum from I equals 1 to n of ci ei. This is just the sum of terms, so A can multiply each term in the sum. So this is equal to the sum from I equals 1 to n of ci A times ei. And ei is an eigenvector of A with eigenvalue lambda I. So we can make use of that fact. So this becomes the sum from I equals 1 to n of ci, and then we get a lambda I ei. Okay? So multiplication by A just means that we multiply each term in this sum by the corresponding eigenvalue lambda I. So what happens if we do this p times? If we do this p times, so x sub p, which is going to be A raised to the p power times x naught, that's equal to the sum from I equals 1 to n of ci lambda I raised to the p power times ei. Okay? Just multiply by the eigenvalue p times. What can we say about xp? So remember, lambda 1 is the dominant eigenvalue. So lambda 1 to the p is going to be a much larger number than lambda 2 to the p or lambda 3 to the p. So let's factor out that first term. So we can write xp if we just write the first term here. So we have c1 lambda 1 to the p times e1 plus the remaining terms, which is the sum from I equals 2 to n of ci lambda I to the p e I. This is the largest term, so I can factor out the lambda 1 to the p, so lambda 1 to the p times c1 e1 plus the sum from I equals 2 to the n ci lambda I over lambda 1 raised to the p power times ei. Okay? If I write it in this way, it's clear that disregarding the lambda 1 to the p piece, if you compare c1 e1 to each term in this sum, it's clear that the terms in the sum are going towards zero relative to c1 e1. Lambda I over lambda 1 raised to the p power is being driven down to zero because lambda 1 is the largest, in absolute value, the largest eigenvalue. So this is being driven to zero. So if you multiply by a enough times, a good approximation to this is just the leading order term, which will be lambda 1 to the p times c1 e1, okay? The dominant term. That's why it's called the dominant eigenvalue. Okay, so can we pick out lambda 1 if we wanted to solve for lambda 1? Well, if we go one more, so we go x to the p sub p plus 1 multiplied by a again, this is approximately lambda 1 to the p plus 1 c1 e1. And we want to kind of clear the eigenvector and the c1. So we can do the following trick. We can solve for lambda 1. Lambda 1, we can take xp transpose and multiply by xp plus 1. And then we'll have an extra factor of lambda 1 in the numerator and simply divide by xp transpose times xp. And you'll see that if you do this, you'll just pick out lambda 1, okay? So by repeated multiplication by a, the right-hand side, this expansion here, will be dominated by the term containing the dominant eigenvalue, and then we can pick out what that lambda 1 is. E1 is quite simple, so E1 here can be just taken equal to xp, because this is just a constant times E1. So the eigenvector is only unique up to multiplication by a constant. So this is essentially xp, okay? That's essentially what is the eigenvalue power method. There's one more kind of trick you use numerically. The problem of the direct implementation of this method is that you keep multiplying by lambda 1. If lambda 1 is larger than 1, you can get larger and larger values for xp, and you can end up with overflow, right? You can get larger than the largest value that you can represent on the computer. Or if lambda 1 is between 0 and 1, you can get underflow. You can drive down to something smaller than you can represent on the computer. So there's an easy way to fix that. So to prevent underflow or overflow, making the numbers too small or too large, with each iteration, instead of keeping xp, you can send xp to xp divided by a normalized value. So you can normalize by xp transpose xp to the 1/2. So essentially the length of xp. And that stops the values from overflowing or underflowing. So just a little extra trick in the numerics. So let me summarize. To find the eigenvalues and the eigenvectors of the method, use the MATLAB built-in routines. That's your best choice. But what I want to do here is to show you how it's really not that hard, at least to find the largest eigenvalue of the matrix and its associated eigenvector. That's the power method. All you have to do is start with some initial vector, x naught. It could be anything. And then just repeat, multiply it by A, by your matrix. And when you do that, the result is going to end up being, give you the dominant eigenvalue and the dominant eigenvector. We can work a simple example in the next video. I'm Jeff Chasnov. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.